Hi, everyone, and welcome to tonight's 15th anniversary screening of Citizen McCaw. I'm Jerry Roberts. This is my partner, Hap Freund. And we're very honored to lead tonight's community discussion about the future of State Street 2123. Some guys are like panicked. Oh, no. No, that was a joke. Newsmakers is a free hyperlocal video news site focused on Santa Barbara that every week brings together an all-star panel of top local journalists for behind-the-scenes analysis and commentary. We've been at this since 2014, and you can find us on TVSB or on our YouTube channel at newsmakerswithjr.com. As a news organization, we are guided by two traditional, historic, and abiding principles of the industry. The first is from C.K. Chesterton, who said, "Journalism largely consists of shouting, 'Lord Jones is dead,' to people who never knew Lord Jones was alive." And the other is that Civil War definition of a reporter. "A journalist is one who watches the battle from high atop a faraway hill, then rides down to shoot the wounded." Well, we really are, I think, blown away and also humbled by this turnout. And right at the start, I want to recognize a community icon who is with us tonight, Barney Branningham.
Way in the back.
Where is he?
Way in the back, all the way in the back. Last row.
Barney, as you know, is not only Mike Royko of Santa Barbara, whose column covered the community with wit and understanding and insight for many years, but it was also his resignation after a bunch of editors that nobody had ever heard of that really, I think, snapped people to attention in Santa Barbara in 2006. Now, we know everyone came to see the movie, not to listen to speeches, but Hap has just a few brief welcoming comments.
All right. It's a sight gag. I was just kidding. I also wanted to welcome you and thank you all for coming. I know that you had a choice to stay home and watch the Republican candidate debate at the Reagan Center, but you chose to come here, so, or maybe you're here by mistake. We want to extend our sincere thanks to the Marjorie Luke Theatre and their great crew, Sierra, Peyton, and Karen, and to acknowledge this event is supported in part by a grant from the Marjorie Luke Theatre Dreyer Family Rent Subsidy Fund. Yes. And special thanks to the news organizations that helped us promote this event, apparently successfully. KCSB, The Daily Nexus, Montecito Journal, Santa Barbara Independent, Ed Hat, and TVSB, who are recording this event to air later on Channel 17. And we also want to thank and acknowledge the makers of Citizen McCaw, and some of them are with us tonight. Co-producer and community treasurer, Rod Latham. The great cinematographer. Yes, thank you. It's too many syllables for me. Brent Sumner, who also edited it. Jesse Rhodes, who wrote the music. And thanks to three other filmmakers who couldn't be here tonight, Sam Tyler, Pete Seaman, and Chuck Minsky. And finally, special thanks to both Rod Latham and Sam Tyler for helping us fund tonight's event.
All right, well, as you all know, Santa Barbara's historic daily newspaper has filed for bankruptcy, gone out of business after more than 150 years of publishing. So our program tonight in some ways marks the end of an era. And with Citizen McCaw, we look back to understand how this happened. But more importantly, we want to stimulate a community conversation that looks forward and ahead about the profound importance of local news reporting as a watchdog of the public interest. So after the film, we hope you'll stay for our discussion. We have a terrific panel we brought together to talk about the future of local news. And finally, we want this night to be a celebration of the local journalism that remains, and to urge everyone to support the people and organizations that we are blessed to have, laboring day in and day out to cover our community with scarce resources and tight budgets. Shout out to Jim Lemon and his team at KEYT, now the largest newsroom in the county. Lauren Bray at Ed Hat, Mark Whitehurst of Voice Magazine, and Laura Ward, publisher of the Ojai Valley News and Ventura County Sun, I think, who is here tonight. And a special salute to a couple of news hounds with us tonight, I think, who really do make a big difference in our community. Josh Molina, who covers, where's Josh?
Stand up. Somewhere.
Stand up. Josh, as you know, covers politics and public policy for NewsHawk when he's not doing his podcast. He is the Rogan, the Joe Rogan of Santa Barbara with the Santa Barbara Talks. Gwyn Lurie, who was on our panel, for her commitment. Gwyn, where's Gwyn? Stand up. Stand up. And last but not least, from the Santa Barbara Independent, publisher Brandy Rivera, who, where's Brandy? Who navigated and steered the paper through the dark days of the pandemic. Editor-in-chief Marianne Partridge, a rock of community journalism. Marianne is in the house. And of course, the angry poodle his own self, Nick Welsh. Nick Welsh is here. He told me he was going to do what he did when he was a teenager going to mass, which is come late and lurk in the back. So I'm...
All right, enough talking. It's time, let's watch the movie.
The situation in Santa Barbara is really the future of journalism in a nutshell. Is it all about money? Is it about ethics? Is it about public responsibility? And what you see here in this, it's a cautionary tale. It's a morality play.
The rest of the country, we have daily papers sort of shrinking and, you know, retrenching slowly. Here, it's pedal to the metal, you know, journalistic suicide, Harry Carey.
Wendy said, and she said word for word, this is war. You're either with us or you're against us.
I don't know of any mass resignation in the history of American journalism.
The freedom of the press at a local newspaper is the freedom of the owner to publish whatever they want.
So if the publisher wants to be a William Randolph Hearst and start a war in Cuba, they can do it.
This story scares people. With corporate owners divesting themselves, anyone could buy a paper. Well, anyone with enough money.
The role is to uncover the truth and to have no sacred cows, and there's nobody that you can't write about, and there's no friend of the publisher.
It's got heroes, and it's got heart, and it's got a little humor, and it's got a diabolical bad guy.
I'm not afraid of her just because she has a lot of money.
Today's front page smear, as regards to me, is false, defamatory, and malicious.
He will not back down from the truth. He spent his entire career in journalism fighting to get out the facts, truth, and honesty.
If that story showed up in any respectable newspaper, heads would roll.
But it is her paper. I guess she gets to do what she wants.
You're right, Mr. Thatcher. I did lose $1 million last year. I expect to lose $1 million this year. I expect to lose $1 million next year. You know, Mr. Thatcher, at the rate of $1 million a year, I'll have to close this place in 60 years.
I came to the paper in 1960, and T.M. Stork, the legendary owner, publisher, manager, editor, he'd owned it, well, since 1901. And he was a tough, gruff old guy. But he loved this town, I'll tell you that. And everything he did with that paper was for the what he thought was for the benefit of the city, because he loved the town.
In 1962, Stork won a Pulitzer Prize for his editorials exposing the John Birch Society, setting a clear standard for the paper with his motto, to report the news without fear or favor of friend or foe. Years later, after the paper was sold to the Philadelphia Bulletin, which in turn sold it to the New York Times Company, the Stork legacy remained intact. Local readers in Santa Barbara would no more miss what their favorite writers like Barney Brantingham, John Zant, Melinda Burns, or Starshine Rochelle had to say than skip their morning coffee. In July 2000, 5 years after she moved to Santa Barbara, Wendy McCaw paid over $100 million to buy the News Press.
At the time, I was very optimistic. I grew up the Santa Barbara News Press, and I kind of thought we'd end up with another Stork type of situation.
Fill up the newspaper, but local stories and local writers, and a woman maybe more sensitive to women's issues. You know, it was an exciting time.
Personally, I feel like I like Wendy. I own my own nonprofit helping shelter animals, and I've read that she's adopted several homeless cats and she's a vegetarian.
I remember thinking at the time, a lot of people were happy, oh, we have local ownership. And I said, well, that's good. Who is it?
She was born Wendy Patrak in Northern California, graduated from Stanford in 1974, married her college sweetheart, and moved to Seattle, where they did very well for themselves. She was known as a philanthropist.
It's no secret that she gave us $2 million, I think about 4 years ago, with which we built the Wendy McCaw Terrace.
An animal rights supporter who, along with her former husband, donated millions of dollars to Free Willy. Why did McCaw, who had no experience in journalism, want to buy the News Press anyway? People joked that the intensely private McCaw bought the paper to keep her name out of it. Others said she bought it because she could, having won one of America's largest divorce settlements ever from cell phone pioneer Craig McCaw. Wendy's share was estimated to be at least $500 million.
I'm coming back to America to take charge. I think it would be fun to run a newspaper. I think it would be fun to run a newspaper.
When she bought the paper, the industry paid attention.
I think that sometimes you're going to get a great owner who happens to be an individual and will be a better owner than a corporation might be. In other times, maybe not.
Please let me be clear that I plan to leave day-to-day management and editorial direction of our paper to the professionals who run it. An essential reason for buying the News Press is to preserve its independence and integrity.
I think Mrs. McCaw's idea was to put out a really great paper. I think that's why she hired Jerry.
I was prepared not to like him, but right from the very start, I did. He's the best editor I ever had. He's a combination of professional savvy, humor. He knows how to get along with people. It was a great era.
When he arrived, there was great euphoria in the newsroom because here was a guy who had incredible credentials. He came from the Chronicle to our little paper.
A former publisher of mine at the San Francisco Chronicle once defined working for a newspaper this way. We're in the truth business, he said. And what he was saying is that the single most important asset of any newspaper
is its credibility.
We were being encouraged to be enterprising and creative and fun and hardworking, and it felt like a family.
The truth is that under Jerry's editorship, the Santa Barbara News Press covered a lot more stories and covered them in depth than it has for years.
I do feel that one of the reasons the Independent had been so successful for so long is that we didn't have always the strongest competition from the news press that we could have.
Roberts comes in, and they were on stuff faster.
Here's a flight, Joe.
So it used to be stories that you go, we don't need to worry about that, it'll be 3 weeks. No, they'd have it in 2 weeks. No, they'd have it in 1 week. No, they knew it before we did.
Everybody was so jazzed about working on the projects and everything, and we were really moving ahead, and we really had in sight that one day we are going to win a Pulitzer.
The newsroom staff was hungry to do great journalism, and I think we're looking for direction and even encouragement and permission to go out and do that. And so it was extremely energizing and extremely exciting to be able to sit down with the reporters and talk about their beats and talk about the stories that they wanted to do, and then to be able to say, go do that. That's a great story. Go get that story. That's, you know, we'll put that right on the front page.
With Roberts in charge of transforming the newsroom, McCaw hired Travis Armstrong, an editorial writer for the San Jose Mercury News, to run her opinion pages. It did not take long for the McCaw-Armstrong worldview to become clear. Readers were presented with two dominant themes. First, an impassioned advocacy for animal rights, and second, a steadfast pitching of her libertarian beliefs, limited government, and a general disdain for elected officials.
The editorial writers and the publisher should meet, formulate a point of view, and ultimately the publisher makes a decision about what the editorials will say. And that's as it should be.
Every letter to the editor I've written in support of animals or in different things like the squirrel poisonings on Leadbetter has made it into the papers.
But to some readers, her support of animal rights seemed far-fetched.
With regard to her paper, I don't think it's very balanced. I think it's she's a little obsessive about it, actually. So,
normally at this time of year, we would assist the Food Bank of Santa Barbara County in its effort to supply Thanksgiving turkeys for needy families in the area. It's going to be a little different this year. We understand that roasted turkey with all the trimmings is a holiday tradition, but we cannot in good conscience recommend continuation of a tradition that involves the death of an unwilling participant. Beans and rice are a good protein substitute for turkey.
I don't know what side of bed Travis Armstrong wakes up on, but every side is the wrong side, and he takes it out on the readers. And particularly if you happen to be a woman elected official, there seemed to be a special place in Travis's hell for you.
His writings are half-truths and non-truths, and they pull things out of context.
The attacks were very, very personal, and they were often very sly, implying something but perhaps not absolutely saying it.
In a way, I almost feel like we're being held hostage by the newspaper. You know, we're not allowed, if we speak out, if we respond, we get it in one way or another. We get named in the editorial, you get a threatening letter, some people are being sued.
Although sometimes irritating to the newsroom, it is okay, according to the Journalism Ethics Code, for McCaw and Armstrong to take whatever stand they choose on the opinion pages. This principle is known as the wall.
This metaphorical wall that exists in between the newsroom and the editorial, the opinion side of the paper. You first start learning about this wall in Journalism 101.
The ethics of journalism are written down and plainly stated by the Society of Professional Journalists in its Code of Ethics. Most American newspapers operate under a so-called church-state structure in which news gathering and reporting operations function separately and independently from the editorial opinion page.
The editorial page is the place for opinion, but the news column should be written in a way that make it possible for someone to consider the newspaper an honest broker of what's happening and give a factual, objective version of what's happening.
While tensions built on each side of the wall, readers were treated to increasing local coverage and features, including restaurant reviews by local bon vivant Arthur von Wiesenberger, who happened to be Wendy McCaw's boyfriend. Nicknamed Nipper, von Wiesenberger was the premier local food critic. and achieved a certain celebrity status through his occasional televised restaurant reviews. But he was best known as an expert on designer water, having written extensively on that subject.
Greetings, Globetrotters and armchair travelers. Welcome to yet another edition of Around the World. I'm Arthur von Wiesenberger.
And he appeared regularly on the News Press radio station, AM 1290, with his own program about travel and the good life.
Just a tiara's toss away from sailing in the Caribbean.
Why it all came undone when it did, what was going on internally that drove Joe out of favor, is a subject of speculation, no knowledge. I mean, was it that, you know, her romance and relationship with Nipper was such that, you know, she could not see how she could run a paper without Nipper there by her side, and there wasn't room in the boat for both Nipper and Joe, and Nipper tossed Joe overboard? I don't know. It looks like that.
He kept everything in place. He kept her away from editorial and allowed an award-winning newspaper that won a lot of awards over years to stay intact. Once he retired, shit hit the fan.
To replace Cole, McCaw announced that she and von Wiesenberger would become co-publishers.
In our management training class, there were several times when Arthur von Wiesenberger made an appearance, and he opened his comments saying, "I don't know about newspapers, but I know about restaurants." What does that mean? What is he talking about? This is a co-publisher of a newspaper making an analogy to restaurants?
As for von Wiesenberger's qualifications, the press release noted that he had worked on his prep school newspaper in Switzerland. With the new co-publishing team just barely into their co-job, the storm hit. In May of 06, Travis Armstrong was arrested for driving under the influence. When von Wiesenberger challenged editors on how they planned to cover the story, tensions between the newsroom and the co-publishers escalated.
What I do know is that a story on his sentencing was killed. This DUI arrest, this was 0.23. It was nearly three times the legal limit. It was the wrong way on a one-way street in downtown Santa Barbara.
Well, by then, there was very little hierarchy, you know. So the decision was, it was Arthur and Wendy's, essentially. There wasn't somebody in between them.
It's journalism 101. It's the roles and responsibilities of journalism to the community.
We expect that the decisions that are going to be made about the news will be made without regard to the interests of the owner. That the newsroom will be able to operate independently and make professional choices about the news.
Shortly after the Armstrong sentencing squabble, there was another confrontation between the co-publishers and the newsroom. The flashpoint was a zoning hearing about a routine dispute over the size of a proposed house. Well, routine by Montecito standards.
Thank you for having me in front of you today. I'll try to make my remarks brief because we have a lot of speakers, but as an actor with a camera and a microphone, it could get ugly.
Lowe had no idea just how ugly. When the paper printed the address of his still vacant lot, the irate actor canceled his subscription. McCaw, irate because Lowe was irate, complained about offending the Lowes and other high-profile readers, and then reprimanded her editors and reporters.
The odd thing was he'd actually been interviewed by Cammie at the meeting, so he knew that there was a piece going in, obviously, and that part of the reason that he called, and he knew that his address had been broadcast on public access television. He knew that it was in the staff report, and he knew that Cammie had it. Nonetheless, the next day there was hell to pay for having let this address get through. There were a couple things that were disturbing about it, one of which is that we violated a policy that heretofore had not existed. That's a dangerous thing. The other thing is it created two classes of people, friends of Wendy and everybody else.
It was the paper's long-standing, albeit unwritten, policy to avoid the publication of personal residence addresses unless clearly relevant to the story.
When we're talking about a major land use issue in Montecito involving a high-profile celebrity, and it's controversial in the community, printing an address is, again, journalism 101.
Whether something as trivial as a movie star's address or as critical as the fate of a president, the principle is the same. Journalists need to be free of any obligation other than the public's right to know. Ben Bradley served as editor of the Washington Post during the Watergate scandal.
Nothing's riding on this except the First Amendment of the Constitution, freedom of the press, and maybe the future of the country. Not that any of that matters.
Responsibility lies in that word, serve. They have to serve the community by presenting a daily account of what's happening, why it's happening, and what's going on out of sight. That's terribly important. I mean, there are a lot of people trying to keep things out of the paper, and a lot of time should be spent on getting them in the paper.
Our worst fear, my worst fear, as another reporter, Scott Hadley and I, we used to joke about how one day we would walk in and Travis Armstrong would be our editor. The idea of the editorial page editor being an editor, we were like, oh God, but they'll never do that, you know? And then one day it happened.
When I returned to Santa Barbara from vacation a few weeks ago, I learned, as has been widely reported, that in my absence, the editorial page editor was given authority over the news gathering operation with control over the selection, placement, content, and editing of news stories. To me and to others, this change meant that the line between church and state had not only been crossed, but obliterated. So after 32 years in the newspaper business, I felt forced to leave the best job I've ever had because I felt that the clear ethical principles guiding our work and our judgments in the newsroom had been compromised, and I couldn't live with that.
Five top news managers have abruptly resigned, including editor Jerry Roberts. Speaking off the record to KEYT, three former employees say the current management, led by publishers Wendy McCaw and Arthur von Wiesenberger, along with editorial page editor Travis Armstrong, do not have the journalistic integrity to objectively run the paper.
We believe that the alleged ethical violations the paper has been accused of are inaccurate and out of context. Looked at in context and full detail, they are insignificant and no different than issues raised every day in newsrooms everywhere.
We had no idea that it was going to explode into the scene of what happened on Wednesday, July 6th. All of a sudden, I heard a reporter yell that Travis Armstrong is in Jerry's office, and it looks like he's moving boxes.
It was behind glass, so you couldn't hear it, but we were looking at the hand gestures, trying to figure out what was going on.
We see Travis escorting Jerry out of his office.
And at that point, the word got around the newsroom that this was happening. And you have to understand, this was a beloved man being sort of perp-walked out of the building as if he'd done something terrible wrong.
Jane Pulse was crying, and she embraced Jerry, and that's when Travis grabbed Jerry and said, you know, you gotta go.
Something inside of me just snapped. I guess it was just the buildup of all the things that had happened in the last few months, and seeing this man who I respected so much and cared for so much being let out, something inside me just snapped, and I let loose with a vulgarity that I'm not very proud of.
Jane just came out and said, you know, fuck you, Travis, haven't you done enough?
Now, we know that you have come here today to hear from us what's happening at the Santa Barbara News Press. But we have been ordered not to speak to any member of the media.
Can you believe the irony here of us standing in front of a newspaper with our reporters gagged in America?
This is an American tragedy, one that I never thought I would see in my lifetime, and only under the tyranny of a government overthrow and we have learned that it doesn't take a government overthrow to silence our free press.
I've worked there 46 years, and I love that paper. And this has hurt me so much. I look at my friends behind me that I've worked with, and they have tapes over their mouths. They're gagged. I'm crying. I have tears in my eyes. I can't stand it.
There was no attempt to gag or otherwise hinder free speech. I would not permit such a thing. Some disgruntled employees and their allies, commercial and political, are now sniping at this paper and spreading agenda-driven misinformation to other media.
The gag order was, you know, after the resignation, there was so much media attention. So we received a memo as journalists stating that we weren't to speak with anyone.
Here we are, a bunch of people who live to tell stories. And we come to work one day and there's a memo on all of our desks saying that we are not allowed to talk about what's going on in our own company, which seemed the ultimate in ironies. We couldn't turn around. This was the moment where the people who had always been behind the news were thrust in front of it, and we knew there was never going to be any reversing that.
A friend of mine in the law firm has a grandmother in Spain who has no running water and gets her mail by goat cart. So her grandmother called the other day and said, "What's going on with your newspaper?"
People around the country and abroad, even in Europe, have fastened on to this local melodrama. And that is because those of us who work in the national media, myself included, have felt a tremendous shift in winds in this country, where certain things we took for granted about the First Amendment, about our protections as reporters and editors and media institutions, had been challenged in a way we never previously seen.
It's official. Media baron Rupert Murdoch has bought the Wall Street Journal. And while he's promised not to interfere in the journal's editorial policy, he's made that promise before, like when he took over the New York Post and then radically transformed it into a conservative junk news tabloid. He also promised not to make changes to the Times of London.
There will be no fundamental change in the characteristics.
But former editors there say Murdoch complained that too many of their stories had a, quote, left-wing bent, and even called one of their correspondents a, quote-unquote, commie. He broke his promises then. Why should we believe him now?
The problem isn't just Rupert Murdoch. His pursuit of the Wall Street Journal is the latest in a cascading series of mergers, buyouts, and other financial legerdemain that are making a shipwreck of journalism. Public-minded newspapers are being dumped by their owners for wads of cash or crippled by cost-cutting, while their broadcasting cousins race to the bottom.
My attitude on journalism is very simple. I want to make enough money so I can afford you.
When he bought the Chicago Tribune Company, which included the Los Angeles Times, real estate mogul Sam Zell made no secret of his intentions.
But what readers want are puppy dogs, and I mean, we also need to inform the community.
I'm sorry. I can't. You're giving me the classic, what I would call, journalistic arrogance.
His eyes firmly on the bottom line, and his disdain for journalists abundantly clear.
And hopefully, we get to the point where our revenue is so significant that we can do puppies and a rat, okay? Fuck you.
While Zell was alienating his journalists and watching his investment sour, the opposite was happening in Philadelphia, where Brian Tierney led a group that bought the Inquirer and the Daily News and then launched an astounding turnaround.
I think the reason for all that comes back to the most important part of the whole thing, is that the journalism here is better than ever. I mean, the Daily News is stronger than it was a year ago. It has more resources. There's a renewed spirit. They're not worried about, are they going to be put out of business? They know that they have owners that love them, that respect what they do.
The strategy was based on embracing the newsroom. The new owners even signed a pledge promising not to interfere.
I feel like we're kind of getting a little bit of our swagger back, proud about what it is we're doing. I had a journalist write to me a few weeks ago, an email. He's with the Inquirer. He's been here quite a long time. He's a very respected journalist, and he wrote to me and he said how proud he is to be in his neighborhood now talking about things. He said for years it was always when he meet his neighbors they'd be saying, oh, I'm so sorry to hear what's happening at the Inquirer. That's really, you know, I'm so sorry. That's so sad. Blah. Now he said people are saying to him, hey, congratulations. I hear great things about what's going on down at the paper.
In Santa Barbara, the owner and her journalists could find no common ground. While their paper imploded, McCaw and von Wiesenberger continued to vacation in the Mediterranean aboard her 193-foot yacht, Calix, dismissing from afar Roberts and his colleagues as simply being biased.
I think the argument is, do journalists have not the obligation, but the right to report these stories without automatic response from management that this is bias? Because I think the bias is coming from the management and not the reporters.
Some of the people who lost sight of these goals and appeared to use the news press for their own agendas decided to leave when it was clear they no longer would be permitted to flavor the news with their personal opinions.
In essence, she said, the reporters and editors who resigned to enter an uncertain job market were to blame for the paper's problems. So first the head in the sand, then the finger of blame. It was positively Nixonian.
I mean, one of the conditions that would make me resign is if they're told to not cover a story, if they're told how to cover a story, if they're told to keep someone's name out of the paper, to get someone's name into the paper.
That's one reason I left, and that's why one reason why a lot of the editors left. They could not work for a paper where there's an enemies list and there's a good guys list, and you better adhere to that, or you're going to get letters of reprimand, you're going to be in trouble. Who wants to work for a paper like that?
In essence, it came down that the interference and the imposition of a viewpoint that was not driven by facts had reached an intolerable level, and that we chose not to work there anymore. And so, as individuals, we decided that even though it was a catastrophic decision financially, it was a catastrophic decision in many senses professionally, but that it would be more catastrophic and it would be more disastrous to actually stay and work under those conditions.
Then we turned around and went back into the newsroom once Jerry had left, and Travis came back in, and everyone was just sort of standing there stunned and silent. And Travis said, well, I know this is an emotional day for everyone, but we've got to work together to put aside our differences and figure out how to get out a newspaper tomorrow. I'd like to see all the editors, please. And no one moved. And he said, I'd like all the editors to step forward, please, and come talk to me. And there was no movement. And there was silence, and then Scott Hadley said, Travis, there are no more editors.
When I got an advance copy of Wendy's note to the readers, I thought that was just egregious. I mean, it was something that wasn't just not true, but it was blatantly not true. It was something that readers could tell was not true, and she was putting it on the front page. I had got that copy in the evening, and I talked to my wife, and I was agonizing because I was putting her into a tough position. And you know, she said, you can't work for her for another minute, and that was the way I felt, and so I quit. Yeah.
They said, I can go this far, I can go no further, and when that line was crossed, they acted as a matter of principle. That says to me something that I have long believed. People who are journalists are not journalists because of a paycheck. They're journalists because they feel committed to what they're doing in almost every case.
We believe that most of their comments are a smokescreen to hide their personal agendas.
They could no longer protect us from the management and the dictatorship and the reaching so far into the articles that their fingers were basically on our keyboards. They had families, mortgages, no jobs in the offing, and they left. And then there's the group of us who stayed to fight.
If it was a fight they were looking for, they had come to the right place.
When you get down to Wendy McCaw, the two things that kind of jump out and bite you on the butt are private property. She's interested in her privacy, she's interested in her property. I think she is equipped with a preternatural sort of prehistoric stubbornness, this willfulness. I will do what I will do, and nobody will get in my way. And if you do, you will be buried.
She once sued the state to keep the public off her beach.
Wendy sued the county, and the suit continued for many, many years. She was opposed to any public access. The access that she's talking about is beneath the bluff of her house.
When state courts ruled in favor of beach walkers, McCaw was fined $460,000. She then took her case to the U.S. Supreme Court, which refused to hear her appeal. Soon after, McCaw battled her architect, Brian Canal, in a lawsuit over his fees.
Well, the suit went on for several years, but it was, in a word, it was horrible. The cost of the lawsuit, I know, at our end, was certainly approached $1 million. From the indications that my attorneys got, she spent well in excess of that to try to keep from paying me my $150,000 to $170,000.
Past legal battles would pale as the showdown with Roberts and his newsroom escalated.
I responded that I didn't think there was anything at all wrong with attending a going away party for someone that I had worked with for 20 years. Wendy said, and she said word for word, "This is war. You're either with us or you're against us."
Four men, the generals in McCaw's war, held the fate of her paper in their hands. Travis Armstrong, McCaw's voice on the editorial page, lashed out at influential people and organizations he perceived to be her enemies. Arthur von Wiesenberger, the boyfriend and co-publisher, struck back on his blog, Nippers.com, comparing the Roberts resignation to a rebellion at a hamburger stand where the cook sabotaged the burgers by making pork patties. Barry Capello and David Milstein, McCaw's attorneys, were known for aggressive public confrontations followed by deft legal maneuverings.
There was a lot of distrust, really, I think, a little bit. They hired three or four new reporters immediately in the newsroom, and I was one of them, and so some of the older employees were wondering if we were, you know, in cahoots with the management. And I was in Yolanda Apodaca's office, and the attorney, David Milstein, was there. They said that the newsroom is really defiant right now, and if anybody says anything to you that you feel like you want to come tell us, feel free to.
They were looking for some degree of protection, and they were so scared by Wendy that they went to the scariest, strongest, most powerful macho union they could find, the Teamsters.
While I don't believe that union representation is in the best interests of our employees, the paper, or this community, I respect our employees' rights to make their own decisions.
The vote was held on September 27th at the News Press building, and the union won an overwhelming victory, 33-6, which is almost 85%.
And we thought, okay, here we go. We're going to be able to sit down at the table and finally negotiate. Instead, McCaw filed charges with the National Labor Relations Board that we were coerced by the Teamsters into joining the union.
What distinguishes the News Press, in my experience, is partly the vehemence of the resistance, because it is relatively rare, but also just the complete irrationality of it and the harsh and viciousness of it on a personal level. They have a tool that most employers don't have, which is their own newspaper, but it is a little surprising that they're using it as viciously as they are.
Would you allow a real bully, an entity with a history of being corrupt and full of bullies, into your business and life willingly? Mrs. McCaw will not.
And what I've heard from people who used to go out on the yacht with Wendy is this one guy said, if she had a choice between having a union or shooting Free Willy, the whale that she spent gobs of money protecting, Willy Swiss cheese.
When the reporters placed pro-union signs around town, Barry Capello responded with cease and desist letters.
I was angry and mad, and I'll be damned if I was going to take it, and I didn't. I was at home for 48 hours figuring out different ways of, you know, finagling the way to keep that sign up and going, you know what, I was going to take a stance.
I knew I had freedom of speech hanging in that window with that saying. I felt threatened, by the letter from Barry Coppola. And so therefore I took action with what I thought was right by taking the sign down, replacing with his letter, taking the sign and putting it on the ceiling of my salon so that anybody came in and got their hair washed, looked up and saw the sign, it was still there.
Capello also tried to portray McCaw as a savior.
When Mrs. McCaw acquired the News Press, she saved it from the disgrace of insolvency. After years of losing money, the paper was going to be closed or sold off.
I've heard the charge from Mr. Capello that the paper was not profitable at the time that we sold it. And I can only say, in a word, that's not true. In late 93, we put online a substantial printing facility in Goleta. Toward the end of 94, and then for the ensuing 4 years, the paper was not only was it profitable, but by the end of that time in 99 was extremely profitable.
Numerous attempts were made to include McCaw's position in this film.
I've made my comments.
We're trying to make this a balanced, open film.
I've given questions to Wendy McCaw, Travis Armstrong, Agnes Huff, and David Milstein.
That's not Barry Coppola, Mr.
And
Tyler.
Well, I gave them to you, too, and David Milstein. 9 p.m., May 2nd, 2007. Craig Smith is preparing his daily blog on the News Press debacle, reporting an almost 10% decline in subscribers. Ironically, the paper's failure to cover itself fuels the rise of other media, the emerging blogs and the two other Santa Barbara papers, The Independent and The Daily Sound.
We were so excited. It was our first issue. Passing out the papers, we realized, you know, this is going to start creating a lot of buzz. People are going to want to know what the Santa Barbara Daily Sound is. So I decided we really need a website. So I sat down on my computer to register santabarbaradailysound.com, which I thought was the most logical choice for a website. And when I went to register it, the site was taken. It had already been registered. So I went to this database online, which is the Who Is database, and it turns out that a company here in Santa Barbara named Evans, Hardy & Young, which is an advertising agency, registered our domain names the day before we published.
We purchased the domain name santabarbaradailysound.com at the request of Mr. Joe Cole, the then publisher. Any questions regarding the domain name should be directed to the Santa Barbara News Press.
Into 2008, the News Press continued to deny Gordon his rightful web domain. By fall 2006, the News Press had become Santa Barbara's top story, yet the paper rarely reported on itself. These are some headlines that readers would never see.
Chicago, August 26th. Roberts and colleagues are honored with Ethics Award from the Society of Professional Journalists. McCaw warns the society that it's being used. Santa Barbara, November 11th. Union supporters rally at an awards dinner for three distinguished citizens. One winner stuns the audience by announcing she wants to buy McCaw's paper. Travis Armstrong leaps to her defense.
Travis was trying to tell me once again that I had been rude, and I said, Travis, one of the things I'm going to enjoy if I do own the paper is firing me.
October 24th, reporter Melinda Burns, a 23-year veteran, is fired by McCaw.
But McCaw refuses to recognize our union, and she fired me for helping to lead the union campaign.
McCaw says, not true. The paper canned Burns because of biased reporting. Also during the fall, the community access cable channels remain missing from the News Press weekly TV listings. The paper says, no space. Channel officials charge retaliation for its broadcasts on the paper's troubles.
There was a laziness that set in the newsroom, and they wouldn't just go out and dig. I mean, just look at the story on the trees.
I got called into Wendy's office. She tells me first thing, this story was biased. Mayor Marty Bloom is quoted several times, and she didn't think the mayor needed to be quoted that many times. I don't like the mayor being quoted in my paper. It didn't say enough negative about the trees being cut down as part of this downtown renovation project.
I phoned some people that I knew were tree people, botanists, Santa Barbara beautiful people.
She went to much greater lengths than I or most reporters would have done.
It's not really an option to start making this stuff up.
Botanical groups and tried to find somebody who was against this removal. The only person who was her publisher.
So I wrote the story.
I didn't say I was not going to give Anna a written reprimand. I just didn't do it. I gave her this report instead of a written reprimand. And I ended it with, so please let me know what you think, Arthur and Wendy. And then I found out what they thought, because the following Thursday, they fired Anna Davison, and the following Friday, I was fired.
Another mass firing of Santa Barbara News Press reporters rocks the paper's already shaky foundation.
The former workers are among more than 30 that have either resigned or been fired in a dispute that began last July.
This is what we were fired for engaging in a federally protected activity of holding signs and a banner on the Anapamu Street footbridge last Friday in connection with the union's labor dispute and in protest in the firing of Anna Davison.
You know, in our termination, the issue of loyalty was brought up. And these are all very loyal journalists, true to their art. And speaking for myself, I've given this paper absolute loyalty in terms of, for 38 years, giving it the best writing I'm capable of.
Well, I did jot some things down because I'm frankly not used to talking to reporters. I'm used to being one.
I've been the crime and courts reporter for the last 8.5 years.
And really, Santa Barbara, this is about you. What kind of paper do you want to have representing your town?
I remember saying to somebody, well, it could be me tomorrow.
Hi, everybody. My name is Barney McManigal.
These latest firings reignited a storm of controversy in the community, both pro and con.
Well, I'm very much against unions, and so I can't support that part of it. And I am also very much in favor of business owners being able to do what they want.
Wendy owns the paper. She can do what she wants. But we, as the public, don't have to support it.
Well, I think the employees are telling the story. I don't need to tell it. They're all leaving. So all the good writers are leaving, and the paper's almost all ads now.
Reinstate the hate!
Another protest, a huge ad in the newspaper, even a radio talk show. Both sides in the ongoing dispute involving the news press using all means tonight to get out their side of the story.
Top employee at the Santa Barbara News Press says free speech has limitations.
People don't have a lot of rights to a lot of things they say they have rights to. And one thing that kind of kills me is when I hear people say, well, I have a right to free speech. Well, you do under the Constitution, but that involves whether the government denying you your free expression under the First Amendment. Doesn't it really have to do with private companies?
Thomas Stork died before I moved into the neighborhood, but his widow lived right next door to my house. I think about it every single day, how he would turn over in his grave if he saw this paper that he worked so hard to establish, created such a fine reputation for excellent journalism. We cannot let that die.
A lot of people don't know what's going on. They think it's just a basic strike between employers, employees, but for those of us who care about the future very much, the paper is central to the future of Santa Barbara. So we're afraid and we're concerned. That's why we're involved.
The Greater Santa Barbara Clergy Association invited all sides to a forum aimed at finding a way forward.
We did get a letter from the news press indicating they weren't going to come, but we wanted to just make sure, and we never give up here, the clergy, so we wanted to know if there is anyone in the audience who officially could represent the news press. No. Okay. All right.
4 days later, Travis Armstrong attacked the clergy, complaining they were picking on the paper while ignoring more serious problems.
A few quick comments about your desire for the continued success of the news press.
Continued success for the news press. Thank you.
And what about community support and that continued support from the community?
We're very appreciative of it. Thank you.
I mean, if Wendy was articulating some set of principles, you know, that meant anything, that was coherent, that was rational, you know, you would go, okay, we at least have a violent conversation, a conflict of values that's going somewhere. But it's just this smoldering toxicity, this meanness coming out of the De La Guerra Plaza.
McCaw's propensity to unleash her lawyers, no matter what the cost, was well known, and fear crippled the community.
The reason I'm talking right now is because the town has cowered. Until this day, I have cowered. Until this very day, I've decided to say, oh, I don't want to say anything. She's a powerful person. The newspaper is powerful. So everybody's being bullied, and we're cowering.
It's a constant struggle and going on with this feeling that they're still out to get you. You know, you get subpoenas every so often and, you know, there's this feeling that it's so difficult to move on.
Nerves were further frayed when David Milstein was quoted in the New York Times saying, "A cease and desist letter is a form of dialogue." Milstein also crashed a union meeting held at a public library.
And they sat down, and I think we all felt the collective jaw dropping in the room.
It is called rough shadowing or illegal surveillance.
And I think that by his behavior, which was so outrageous, I think that the advertisers who came to the meeting could see what we were up against.
McCaw also sued Santa Barbara SmackDown author Susan Paterno personally, rather than Paterno's publisher, the American Journalism Review, which was soon teetering on the verge of bankruptcy because it had agreed to cover Paterno's legal costs. Capello, in charge of the union battle, subpoenaed all 60 hours of raw footage shot for this film, and he worked on McCaw's breach of contract claim against Jerry Roberts, which was up to $25 million just a week after Roberts announced that he was battling cancer.
At the end of the day, probably the only winners in this entire saga will be the lawyers of Wendy McCaw.
At the News Press, we remain more committed than ever to the values for which we stand: truth, excellence, ethical journalism, and the best coverage of local events that can be had.
But just a few weeks after her commitment, the first section of McCaw's Sunday paper seems short on local stories.
The front page story is dozens clean up beachfront. If you flip to page two, there's a column by Dr. Laura Schlesinger, who passes these days as our local columnist, but that's a whole nother story.
I'm concerned that the lack of information is going to create a scenario where policies could be made without hearing the full story, and we have to live with those policies for a long time afterwards.
No local news on page eight, no local news on page nine.
We had an education celebration, which was very important, had a national speaker, and had a packed auditorium, and unfortunately, the news press was unable to coverage.
I could have sworn that there was supposed to be more than one local story in the paper.
This whole thing is going to be a great sort of test tube, lab condition of, you know, what happens to a community when it doesn't have a daily paper. The rest of the country, we have daily papers sort of shrinking and, you know, retrenching slowly, and the process of erosion is much more gradual. Here, it's pedal to the metal, you know, journalistic suicide, Harry Carey.
No local news on page 16, so unless you're really into beach cleanup, there's not much that the Sunday paper offers you, local news-wise.
A lot of times you'll read the news press and you get done and you wonder if you ate.
It isn't so much that they don't live up to the standards that I have or the standards that other people have. They don't live up to their own standards. Their own self-proclaimed standard means nothing to them. If they believe in the best journalism, you cover the city council, and you certainly do talk to the mayor. If you believe in local coverage, then you don't fire the reporters who are doing the best local coverage and replace them with interns.
It really is essential, I think, for newspapers to provide that kind of information to people so that there is a commonplace and there is a discussion, a point of departure for discussion and debate and mutual understanding of the community. Somebody once said that a local newspaper is the glue that holds a community together.
The chronicler of our history is not recording these events. How sad. But then the question becomes, what do we make of all of this, and what do we do? I think we all need to acknowledge, openly, individually, at our own pace, that this storied institution that we have cherished for so long is dead.
Thank you.
While McCaw's news press gave short shrift to the crucial issues facing the community, it had been busy, ominously, on other fronts.
Do any of you know Jerry Roberts well, including how he conducted himself at the paper to the point that you would stand by him no matter what?
4 days later, an anonymous blogger joined Capello in fueling the speculation. Stay tuned, was their implication. A bomb is about to drop.
The story reads, News Press seeks exam of computer used by ex-editor containing child porn. Jerry Roberts, his wife and attorney, held a press conference today to deny any involvement. His attorney says the computer had hard drive in question was bought used by the paper.
First of all, thank you all for coming. From the first day of this controversy at the News Press, the story has been about ethics, and today the shameful ethics of the News Press and its owner are on full display for all the world to see. All I know is they put a story on the front page of their newspaper which suggested I had something to do with child pornography. And that suggestion is false, defamatory, malicious, and was published with full knowledge that it was untrue without giving me a chance to comment. My family and I are outraged beyond measure at this desperate attempt to ruin my reputation. As a journalist, it is notable to me that this cowardly story was published without a byline and without any attempt to contact me for comment in advance of its publication. Finally, I want to say that I have been honored and humbled to receive the support and help from hundreds of people in this community during this awful legal and journalistic assault by Ampersand and its owner. And I want to just introduce my wife again, Linda Kiefer, and she just has a couple of brief comments to make as well.
You know, when Jerry first told me about the opportunity to come down to Santa Barbara and to work here, he said they were looking for an experienced professional journalist. And that's exactly what they got. $1 billion. And this outrageous accusation is not going to intimidate him. And our family is very proud of him because he will not back down from the truth. He spent his entire career in journalism fighting to get out the facts, truth, and honesty.
If that story showed up in any respectable newspaper, the Washington Post, the New York Times, the Los Angeles Times, with no byline and no comment from the target, heads would roll.
Roberts had passed a voluntary lie detector test, and authorities had refused to press charges against anyone weeks before the article appeared.
Anybody who knows Jerry, you know, just knows it's absurd. And it was clear to me reading it that the paper did it on purpose to smear him. There was no journalistic reason to report that story.
Instead of the headline pointing out that it was a computer that many people had used, they keyed into the fact that it was Jerry Roberts who had used it.
Who knows what was in that computer? It's my assumption that that stuff was already in there when they bought it and didn't know enough to look into it. But the paper was in Wendy McCaw. They were after Jerry Roberts, and they said, aha, we've got him. We can't prove it, but we'll write a story that smears him.
You couldn't even go near a story suggesting child pornography without a host of lawyers vetting it. And you make an allegation like that, who's your writer? Where is the byline? Where is the comment? Where's the proof?
The people who had actually gone home and thought that they'd finished laying out the paper were pretty surprised when they opened it the next day and found something on the front page that they had never seen and was never scheduled. My understanding is the person that was in charge of getting things in like that at the last minute was Scott Stapleton.
Would you tell us who authorized putting the story about Jerry Roberts in the Sunday paper? Would you tell us if anybody spoke against that idea?
Do you believe it's fair and ethical journalism not to print another side to a story? Do you have anything to say at all about this?
3 weeks after the first article appeared, the news press offered not the retraction that Roberts had demanded, but what they called a clarification.
It's a smear of a McCarthyite dimension. Once you're tarnished with it, even if you're proven, if it's proven that it's all a concoction, you know, some part of that stays with you, and it's very, very hard to what do you do, go up on a street and say to somebody, I'm not a communist, I'm not a child pornographer.
Let us not assassinate this lad further, Senator.
Look.
You've done enough. Have you no sense of decency, sir, at long last? Have you left no sense of decency?
Never put her on the cover. We kept it to a minimum in every way we can because I didn't want this to turn into some kind of vendetta. But I did know, I mean, it's a small community. I know that he was a wonderful dad and a wonderful grandfather and that mattered in his life, being that kind of a person, that mattered to him. And to be hit like that in public by something that it was a rock foundation of the man's life as a human, forget any job description, was so shocking. And that another newspaper, a journalistic newspaper, could put something like that out, it was a shame.
The other part of it is it trivializes an important issue. I said in my letter to Ms. McCaw that I'd like to see her do something about child pornography, and I still would.
We intend to write more about the scourge of child pornography, and we intend to uncover and expose anyone, including any former or current employees of our paper, who traffics and delights in the sexual abuse of children. The story has just begun.
If she had waged a child porn crusade through her paper, then you could say, oh, maybe this is consistent. She's written more about a turtle who was tortured by some punk in Ventura, and the legal battle surrounding that, and the rehabilitation efforts undertaken on behalf of that poor turtle, then she's written, editorialized, done anything about kiddie porn.
The Roberts incident drove Luke Cannon to engage McCaw in a war of words. They debated in early summer 2007 in newspaper articles and on websites.
Mr. Cannon once had a reputation as a journalist of note, but his recent op-ed piece exemplifies how so-called journalists have tumbled into incredulity. The world has passed you by.
You've stumbled across an important truth. We live in different worlds. In Wendy's world, a wealthy newspaper owner feels free to smear Jerry Roberts, a most respected journalist, because he rebelled against suppression of the news. In Wendy's world, this owner, you, feels free to smear me because I dared to write the truth about the harm you are causing our beloved Santa Barbara.
Young people today no longer wear watches, no longer read newspapers, no longer watch TV news. They communicate by text messaging and in MySpace. They distrust the mainstream media, in large part because they distrust the decrepit ideas asserted by the old generation, who claim to be experts such as yourself.
Do you really believe you can silence your critics by attacking and trying to intimidate them? Mrs. McCaw, the truth has greater force than all your millions. When do you plan to tell advertisers and your dwindling number of readers that the news press has lost almost a quarter of its circulation?
Now I have a question for you and all those like you who gloat at seeing the union tactics harm our paper. Mr. Cannon, who and what is it that you support? Reporters and editors who've done everything in their power to destroy the local newspaper that they claim to love by urging readers to cancel their subscriptions? People who brought the Teamsters Union with its history of corruption into our small town? Or is it that you love your ancient rejected creed that journalists can do no wrong?
In a town that is largely unsympathetic to organized labor, you managed to treat employees so shabbily that they voted for the Teamsters by a 33-6 vote. The Teamsters should have you for an organizer.
One of the saddest things about the news press situation is how far it takes us from what journalism is about. Almost 100 years ago, Walter Lippmann wrote that the crisis of democracy is a crisis of the press. And what he meant was without a free press, without journalists acting in the way they should to report the best information in the most
unopinionated, unbiased way possible, there was no way for democracy to succeed.
In August, the reporters held a reunion in a courthouse parking lot, forced there by a swarm of Capello subpoenas. Ironically, McCaw owned the building and leased it to the government.
When we all got together there right before the trial, it was very emotional. We've been subject to a lot of torment from Wendy's lawyers. We've had trouble finding work. We've had to leave town. We've had to leave our houses. It's just, it's really sad.
The National Labor Relations Board has charged the news press that they unlawfully fired six of the reporters who stood on a freeway overpass and displayed signs that said, cancel your newspaper. The stated reason for the firings were they were biased reporters. And if the news press is found to have violated the National Labor Relations Act, then the reporters can be ordered to be reinstated with back pay.
That's the day of accountability.
Okay. That's the first day of accountability.
Yes, it is.
In your opening statements, you said that you will prove that nobody was fired due to their urge to form a union.
What I said is what I intend to do.
And could you tell me that on camera, please?
I just told you.
Media interest was intense. Craig Smith added a noontime trial update, and even the news press sent a reporter, Hannah Guzik, who soon quit. Word was that she resented pressure on how to report the trial. Over the next several weeks, a parade of witnesses from both sides, including Scott Stapleton, Travis Armstrong, and Arthur von Weisenberger, appeared before Judge Kokel. The issues were complex, but for Melinda Burns, it all boiled down to a few simple words.
Barry Capello asked me about the Code of Ethics for the Society of Professional Journalists. And he asked whether that was what we wanted to be included in our union contract with the news press. And I said, no, what we need is a code of ethics for the publisher. And he became agitated and sort of said something like what? And I got mad and I leaned into the microphone and I said, how about without fear or favor of friend or foe?
The trial's low point occurred when Capello, seemingly drawing from the Jerry Roberts child porn playbook, questioned Melissa Evans on the witness stand about a personal health issue for which she had sought treatment.
Well, it was just vicious. I mean, it was an attempt to embarrass me, to intimidate me, to punish me for participating in a union campaign, for daring to question Wendy McCaw, you know, and Barry Capello is an attorney. He's a good attorney. He's paid a lot of money to do his job. And he knew he had a tough case. And I think he was pulling out anything he could possibly find, as low as he could possibly go. I mean, really, what happened in my personal life had absolutely nothing to do with the ethical battle that we were in.
After 3 weeks, the trial concluded with a showdown over why the reporters were fired.
I think the news press potentially could stand a chance of prevailing on those charges if they are willing to call Wendy McCaw, who would be willing to testify under oath that she had been displeased with the reporting of Davis and Burns for some time, and they were fired for those reasons and those reasons only.
There was great anticipation around town as the reclusive McCaw actually took the stand. Under questioning by attorneys for both sides, she gave the judge a glimpse of her feelings about biased reporting.
She didn't seem insincere on the stand. I think she really thought she was ridding her paper of bias. She just seems to be out of touch with the way journalism is done and what bias really means.
The paper's lawyer said they knew that the reporters were biased because they didn't put in the other side, i.e., the editorial position of the paper. I sat there that day. I wanted to get up and say, excuse me, Your Honor, that isn't done at a newspaper. I didn't, and I shouldn't have, but I still can't believe that.
Craig Smith blogged his observations about McCaw's testimony.
You could almost see McCaw's blood pressure rise as she talked about Davison's reports.
Her description of Davison as being a shill and the handmaiden of government wildlife regulators seemed better reserved for someone who had committed treason rather than someone who had written about sea otters.
The overarching issue is that the owner of your TV station can tell you what news to cover, and a publisher can tell the reporters what news to cover and what news not to cover. That is set forth in cases from the Supreme Court on down in this country. It is the publisher's right for freedom of the press, not reporters.
After McCaw's appearance, the trial quickly wound down. The judge announced that it could take several months to rule on the evidence.
It's been said that justice delayed is justice denied. How many years will it take for us to be reinstated to our jobs?
On November 6, 2007, Penn, an international writers group, honored Roberts and his colleagues with their third major award since the resignations.
There were some people at Penn who brought up privately, could it be possible that Wendy McCaw would sue Penn, the very organization to honor reporters and writers? They came to realize that we cannot defend those in Darfur or North Korea or China if we cannot defend people right here in Santa Barbara.
Overcoming their qualms, Penn gave Roberts the First Amendment Award, presented by Taylor Hackford, Academy Award-winning director of Ray and formerly a News Press paperboy.
Every town in America has a local paper. Some are more than a vehicle for local merchants and real estate brokers. Some are more ambitious. Some are great. The News Press was great. That tradition of journalistic excellence lasted a long time, until a few years ago, the News Press was purchased by billionaire Wendy McCaw. Then all hell broke loose. It's not a particularly original story, just a stale old tale of a powerful owner asserting control over the editorial page and then taking aim at the newsroom. But in this instance, the action was played out like a John Ford Western. There's always a wall between editorial and news. Jerry Roberts quit because Wendy McCaw tore that wall down. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Jerry Roberts.
Fighting litigation filed by a billionaire newspaper owner that threatens to financially ruin my family, I have quite naturally spent a lot of time in the past year reflecting on the choices I faced and made in leaving the paper. And I can tell you that it's not an easy thing for people with kids or mortgages or medical problems to go home and tell your family you've left your job for an issue of principle. The people who did that in Santa Barbara, many of whom are seated here tonight, journeymen and rookies alike, and they're the people to whom this award belongs, did not make this decision lightly. In the news business, when we talk about the First Amendment, we most often refer to our rights under freedom of the press, unique constitutional rights granted to no other industry. But in exchange for the constitutional right of freedom of expression, journalists also bear a unique responsibility, and that is to do our work as if it were a public trust.
The day after the Penn Awards, editor and publisher reported new circulation figures. It was a setback for McCaw. Although newspaper circulation is in decline nationwide, the drop at the News Press was among the worst in the country. The paper lost 14% of its readers in just 6 months. Some locals wouldn't take the paper, even if it was free.
Well, I felt like I lost a child. Something that I woke up to every day that wasn't there. I lost something very important, a connection to my community.
Wendy McCaw has turned out to be a terrible disappointment to the community. I feel that she's not held up for part of the bargain, which is an immensely powerful bargain between the media and the people of this country, because I think that is the basis of democracy.
Well, I think it's unfortunate, and I think we need a change, probably a change in ownership. It's a disaster.
The end of 2007 brought more bad news for McCaw.
The law has finally caught up with
Wendy McCaw.
The day after Christmas, Judge Kochel surprised everyone with a swift, decisive verdict.
We feel vindicated, and how. This is a big win. It's a new year.
Judge Kochel found all of the employee witnesses to be credible.
These employees did the right thing, that they were unlawfully discharged, that they did not write biased stories, that they were unfairly treated, and that they should be rehired.
We've won another battle, but we are far from done, since the news press reflexively announced we'll appeal this decision.
Somebody said she's going to take it to the World Court in The Hague. Who knows where it's going to go?
The news press reported the judge's decision and its own appeal on page 4 of the January 1 issue. The front page contained McCaw's annual letter to readers.
Welcome to the new year, when we again take stock of the accomplishments of the past 12 months and set goals for the next. We expanded our local news coverage in various ways, from local columnists covering disparate aspects of our community to an internationally recognized columnist bringing the latest local buzz. We enter this new year with optimism and the commitment to serve you with accurate local news and information in a variety of media to meet your needs.
Since she refuses interview requests, McCaw left locals wondering about the apparent disconnect in her New Year's message. The question being, how did she really feel about events? The drop in local news coverage and subscribers, the rise in legal battles, and about the often unflattering attention she attracted. If a lunchtime stroll with her co-publisher during a break from a trial was any indication, she seemed oddly unaffected, even amused, as her lawyer played to the camera.
Wendy McCaw, she can buy a fantastic mansion. She can buy one of the great yachts of the world. She can buy teams of lawyers.
So therefore you insult me?
I didn't insult you, I said you were insulted.
And she even can buy a newspaper, but it stops at the point where you cannot buy the news. And I think that minor distinction between buying the newspaper and buying the news somehow eluded her. Someone to listen to stories
and tell. The broad responsibility is to serve his readership. Serve it, really serve it. Tell him what the hell is going on and how come. Be not only useful, but essential in making the community work.
If a young reporter would come to me and say, after what we've seen in Santa Barbara, how can you in good faith encourage us to stay in journalism? It's people like you who we're going to depend upon to keep journalism not unflawed, but honest. And so do it, because we need you.
There is an incredible loyalty among people who are devoted newspaper readers. It's such a habit. It's such a sense of personal connection that even in the hands of an abusive owner, their yearning is for it to set itself right rather than to immediately abandon it. It's not like trading cars. It's like getting divorced from a spouse. There is something really powerful about it. And I think that speaks to the power that newspapers still genuinely have as the sort of heart, the beating heart of a community.
I don't talk to reporters that are rude. You're rude. Okay?
You got it.
Okay?
Have a nice lunch.
Subtle salvation in poems and prose, hiding our heads in some shadow of home, and I wasn't looking for either.
I miss the newsroom. I mean, I miss just going in the morning and drinking coffee and having meetings and making wisecracks and, you know, listening to other people and just I miss, you know, being out ahead of the news and knowing stuff 24 hours before anybody's gonna know it. I miss the opportunity to shape the news, to make decisions in a kind of split second way about where we're going, you know, who's going, what are we gonna ask them to bring back. I miss the excitement of, you know, seeing the photographs from the scene of the fire or from the scene and go, yes, we got it, you know, and that's, there's your page one picture. And it's just, it's an atmosphere that, you know, there's no other way to have that much fun legally as there is in working in newspapers. So I miss that.
Desert rats are hustling outside the 7-Eleven. Across the street, the congregation's lining up for heaven. Saw a dolphin and a rainbow in a rooster tail. Floating across the country like a letter in the mail. And west like lines on my hand. Majesty of sunsets always takes me for a ride.
You know, that movie holds up pretty good. I gotta say, 15 years. I mean, they really nailed it. It's all the same. It's all the same stuff. We're just 15 years down the road. Anyway, if you want to share the documentary with friends, it's available on our site, Newsmakers, with JR via our YouTube channel. The film has a cliffhanger ending, and in some ways, a lot has happened in the past 15 years, and in some ways, nothing has changed. While we're setting up for the future of local news panel, we're putting up a couple of slides that chronicle what has happened in the battle between the news press and its employee union, and another that shows what happened in my defense against a billionaire's $25 million lawsuit. Spoiler alert, I won and got paid, finally. And I just want to take this opportunity to introduce some of the people you saw in the film who've been in the middle of this conflict, some of them going on 17 years. First of all, we've got, I think, six of the fired eight, the original employees fired. Melinda Burns, leader of the effort. Stand up, stand up, stand up. And of course, Melinda is continuing to work as a journalist locally, and you've probably read her coverage, very in-depth coverage of about the debris flow and about our cannabis ordinance. And like Newsmakers, she's experimenting with a bold new business model of working for free. And also here's Dawn Hobbs, who was one of the leaders you saw her in the movie. And Anna Davison, not the handmaiden of the U.S. Forest Service. I think Tom Schultz is here somewhere. Tom, you here? Now knocking down big bucks in the software industry. We'll talk to you later. Melissa Evans is here from Long Beach, where she runs the local news operation. And the Hall of Fame sports writer, John Zant, is here. Where's Zant? And some of their colleagues, Cammy Barnwell is here. Cammy was the one that got everybody in trouble by printing by putting Rob Lowe's address in the story for those. And her husband, Brian Barnwell, who was one of the few public officials to stand with the union at that time. I think Jane Hulse is here somewhere. Jane? When Jane got home that day, her husband, who's a great journalist himself, had gotten a cake that was said, fuck you, Travis, on it. Scott Hadley, the first rank and filer to leave. Going on to also make big bucks in Silicon Valley, Starshine Rothschild, our hometown great columnist, using her journalism skills at LinkedIn. Shelley Leachman, is Shelley here? Shelley make it? Okay. She's out at UCSB Public Affairs. Len Wood, our wonderful photo editor. Well, I saw Len earlier. There he is. Nora Wallace, who did such great work for us covering North Bay for many years. Andrea Huebner is here, our very talented page designer. And Payrat is here. You probably know her better as a member of the Brawling Betty's Roller Derby team. I saw Peg Muting on the list. Is Peg here? She's the heart and soul of the advertising. She didn't make it. Mary Koenig, another go-to designer. Mary here? There she is. Marcia Heller. Marcia here, the most eagle-eyed copy editor on earth. She didn't make it. Craig Smith is in the house, the man. Who wrote the indispensable, true, real-time history of this mess. Is Raul here? Raul? My hero. Just be serious for a second. This man gave up his job knowingly by telling me that they were about to drop this bomb on my head. And I will never, ever forget him or stop being grateful for it. Thank you, Raul. Carol Warner is here. She was executive secretary to the owner. She could tell you some stories. And also from, I'd like to introduce from the Teamsters Union, Union Attorney Ira Gottlieb is here. And the indefatigable Teamster organizer, Marty Keegan. Marty's here.
Assembly member Greg Hart is here. I saw him before. Oh, there you are, okay. In the back, Megan Harmon. Are you here? She was coming.
She was here.
She was here and left. Kristen Seddon. Kristen's here. Thank you very much. Jonathan Abood. All right.
Jonathan.
President of the Board of Trustees at City College. Marcia Croninger. There. Marcia here. Thank you. Area trustee. And Kate Ford. Formerly on the school board and now a appointed member of the Harbor Commission. Did I miss anybody? Oscar's here. Where's Oscar?
Oh, yeah, Oscar.
Oscar was
here earlier.
He was here. All right. Anybody else I missed who actually got elected to a public office?
Tora. KEYT Ford really, I think, has the best scam going on. She goes from the school board to the Harbor Commission. Yeah, okay. Although Greg Hart just got back from Copenhagen because he was in Norway touring prisons. Nice, Greg. You figured out that Sacramento junket thing really fast. All right, finally, I want to just acknowledge some people who helped some of us get through this by creating grassroots support and organizations. There was something called the Journalist Loan Fund that helped journalists get by, and also legal representation. And I want to, is Kathleen and Don Scott still here? Kathleen was here earlier. Thank you. There she is. Thank you for everything. And then a bunch of lawyers in town formed something called the Lawyers Alliance for the First Amendment, and they helped me raise a lot of money because we didn't have $1 million for legal fees. And Jana Zimmer and Richard Solomon are here. Thank you very much for all you did. And community hero Ann Tobes, is Ann still here? She stood up for me at a time when it would have been easier not to, I think. And Ann Louise Bardock, who seems to know everyone. She knows everyone in politics, media, law, and entertainment, and she helped spread the word about this, and also managed to get the movie Freeze on her face, which I thought was... And finally, I want to introduce my wife, who was kind of the emotional heartbeat of the movie. Linda Kiefer is here. All right, you good? All right, so we're going to segue into our panel now about the future of local news, if our panelists would make their way to the stage. So in the film, we took a look back to the last decade or more, decade and a half, and now we're going to talk about what has changed in terms of the news business since, spoiler alert, everything, and what it may portend for the business and the cause of local news into the future. And to explore these issues, we've assembled a panel of folks who look at the questions raised with a range of perspective. On my left is Dr. Jennifer Holt, Associate Professor and Chair of UCSB's Department of Film and Media Studies. She is the author or editor of 5 books about digital media and has lectured across the country and around the world on the subject. Her forthcoming book is titled Cloud Policy. Sarah Sinclair is the Advertising Director of the Santa Barbara Independent. And the former advertising director of the News Press. She couldn't stay away from those going away parties. And she has straddled and successfully navigated the epic transition from the before times print business model to the economics of the digital age. Gwyn Lurie is CEO and editor-in-chief of the Montecito Journal Media Group, who led a group of investors that purchased that weekly paper in 2019 and since has launched a series of other publications that provide alternative revenue streams to support community journalism. Lily Dallow is the digital content director at KEYT, a multimedia journalist whose training and skills in telling stories with multiple means of communication, including print, images, audio, and video, position her as a prototypical journalist adapted to the new era of constant technological change. And Ryan P. Cruz is a staff reporter for The Independent who not only covers traditional news beats, but also focuses much of his work on Latino communities and culture, which historically have been overlooked in local news coverage, even as they constitute a growing portion of the population. So I want to frame the discussion this way. Citizen McCaw tells the story of the decline of a local news organization under circumstances that are in many ways uniquely local, we'll say. But in other ways, it's a story that's been repeated again and again across the U.S. since the movie came out over the past 15 years. Not long ago, New York Times executive editor Dean Baquet said, I think most local newspapers in America are going to die in the next 5 years, except for the ones that have been bought by a local billionaire. Well, he was talking about Jeff Bezos, I think. But so more than 2,000 American newspapers have closed their doors and stopped their presses since 2004. Yet a Pew Institute study in 2019 found that most Americans, 3 of 4 respondents, believe that local news outlets are in good financial shape. So there seems to be a blind spot among part of the public about the fact that quality local reporting requires time, expertise, talent, and institutional knowledge. So I want to start talking about what the media landscape looks now to get a better understanding of the world we're living in, the digital information world, and how this change has disrupted the business models of traditional news media, and what local news organizations are doing to adapt and harness the opportunities. And then I want to talk to these two journalists who are young and looking to the future. They're more than geezers like myself. But who have grown up with and currently work in the new media landscape, what they see ahead professionally and personally as a matter of public interest. Jennifer, I want to start with you. Citizen McCaw ends in 2008. What has changed in the way people receive, process, define, and interact with news since then? I know it's absurd to ask her to explain that in 5 minutes, so there is an extended interview with Jennifer on newsmakers.com, but give us the broad strokes of that.
Okay. In 5 minutes or less, it's interesting to talk to a group of people like this who are accustomed to not just creating the news, but reading newspapers. I'm used to talking to an audience of students who have never been taught to read a newspaper, who have never thought to read a newspaper. Their idea of engaging with news is, you know, going like this. And it's a very different cultural experience. And so this is a kind of interesting, different experience for me to talk to people who are used to reading newspapers. I think the biggest deal, obviously, is the shift to digital, but that is not just, that's much more than a change in technology. It's a change in cultural practice. It's a change in business models. So now most of the business revenue goes to Facebook and Google. That's just where it goes, and that's evacuated the support for traditional newspapers to the point that the story we saw just has been repeated thousands and thousands and thousands of times since that film was made. And now nearly two-thirds of the counties in the U.S. have no daily newspaper. And without the local, with the loss of the local, we have a loss of all power for the public and all public accountability, because all seeds of power and political power are sowed locally. And you know, this kind of tragedy that we watched play out on a local level, this is playing out on such a national and global scale now that this is kind of what I think about all the time, the real tragedy that is this compounded over and over. And part of it is a loss of business revenue, a change in the business model. It's also a loss, an evacuation of faith in our idea of the truth. When you go now to read the news, it's choose your own adventure. And you go on a social media site that echoes your own ideological leaning and your own bubble. And we have things called alternative facts. And we have ways of engaging with news that are driven by a data-driven click model that rewards hyper-partisanship, it rewards lies, it rewards salacious content much more than it rewards just run-of-the-mill factual material. So kind of this kind of architecture of social media, which is now an echo chamber, is also a place where lies travel a lot faster than the truth, and they're a lot more profitable than the truth, which is just a sad reality of the landscape that news is existing in online. We also have the spread of fake news at a speed that we can't even keep up with. And frankly, we don't have media literacy programs that are equipped to teach people how to engage with news and discern how what is factual and what isn't. I think any kid who has a phone should be required to take media literacy classes. They can't wait until they meet me when they're 20 years old, or, you know, worse, never take one in the first place. So we don't have any kind of media literacy that approximates the urgent situation that we're in for democracy. And we also have the consolidation of what's left into the hands of private equity firms and vulture capital hedge funds that gut newsrooms like we saw, treat news like it's just a commodity on the open market, and the loss of the local with this loss of public accountability is just a direct line to corruption. I'm from Chicago, so you can just ask me about that. That's our brand. So we learn about that young in where I'm from. But this kind of consolidation of new of what's left, these kind of shells of the newspapers themselves into the hands of private equity has become kind of like the final death knell to me. And we don't have a culture of reading the news. I was taught how to read a newspaper when I was a kid. You open the paper, you look and you see who the Cubs lost to yesterday, and then you go and you read the comics, and then you read about the latest alderman in jail, and your family taught you how to read the paper, and there's a thing, it's on the table, it's a newspaper. We don't have that culture anymore. And so getting kids and getting young people into the habit of wanting to know what's happening and understanding how to read what's in front of them, I think, is another big crisis we're facing.
Given that uplifting assessment, Sarah, you have uniquely had a successful career working to pay for local news as a product, both in the before times, when the business model for dominant daily newspapers is relatively simple. You sell an audience to advertisers that you gather as a general interest publication. But also today, when that model's been demolished, what has changed from your perspective, and what is the key to sustaining a local news enterprise going forward?
That's another big question that answering in 5 minutes is pretty close to impossible. And before I answer, I want to really sincerely thank you and Hap and everyone else who put this evening together. I didn't realize how emotional I was going to be watching the movie again. You know, it was 2008 or 2009 when we all watched at the Arlington. And for me, the trauma of, and I don't use that word lightly, you know, the trauma of what we had just gone through at the news press was such that I think we were clinging together, and now to be able to see the film again and to have it presented in this way with, you know, as again, emotional as I am watching what we had back then, to put it in the perspective of the future is really helpful. And to be able to gather with, you know, friends that I worked with at the news press and current colleagues at the Independent and so many friends and interested people in the community and family members. My mom's here too. So as I said, big question. I'm glad that Jennifer gave her answer from a scholarly perspective, because for me, I've been working really in the trenches on this for the last 37 years. I started at the news press right out of UCSB. I was 24 years old. And I started in 1986, just a few months after the New York Times Company had bought the news press. So when I think about what has changed, back in 1986, you know, besides the fact that the rooms were full of cigarette smoke, we were literally, we were typing on typewriters. I think, you know, I came in as a classified ad sales rep, and we were just transitioning to word processors. But, you know, there was no email, there was no internet. And from a business perspective, and I need to say that everything I'm going to say is from the business side of the paper. So the fact that there was no internet, and, you know, we weren't Googling because there was no Google, and there was no Craigslist, no Indeed.com, no realtor.com, all of those competitors that came along later, we were really selling against TV and radio and the yellow pages. You know, that was our landscape. And so in those 37 years that I've been working in this industry, everything in that regard has changed. All of the platforms that we've used, all the tools have used, but the one thing that has remained the same, and I think it's the key to looking at where we are going forward, is the relationship between trusted local news and readers who want that news, and again, from the business side, the businesses who want to be in front of those readers that want that trusted source. Back in the day at the News Press, and for the 10 years that I've worked at the Independent, you know, our strength is really the quality of our news coverage, and that's where that like triangle relationship that I described comes from. And at the Independent, and I can't help but speak of it from the current Independent perspective. You know, our print product, we have 68,000 readers every week, and 71% of those readers have read at least three of the last four issues, and 58% of those readers have been reading the news, reading the Independent for at least 10 years. And I'll stop with the statistics because you're going to think that I'm trying to sell you something. And, you know, sidebar, I cannot help but sell. It's what I do. And if anyone out there is interested in advertising, you know, come see me. But obviously, readers get their news in different ways now. That's, you know, that's super, super obvious. And I don't need to go into detail on that. So for the Independent, that means that not only do we still have our beloved print product, but we're stoking the fires of our website every day. We have 330,000 readers every month. You're all familiar with that. But we also have broadened our platforms such that we've got a podcast, we've got digital display ads, we've got newsletters, we've got all of these other products, and many of our readers are consuming our product in multiple of those vehicles. So we're living and breathing that every day. However, I can talk about how strong we are, but anyone in this sphere who says they're making money hand over fist is lying. If you've seen this week's issue of the Carpinteria Coastal View, they have a full page notice on page 3 telling their readers, you know, and their loyal little Carpinteria readers, that if they don't get more support, they're going to be closed by the end of this year. So, you know, that's the reality that we're facing. One leg of the stool that we haven't talked about, and it's an area that we newly focus with the Independent, is reader revenue. So we have ways that our readers can support us through donations and subscriptions. We have a nonprofit fund called the Mickey Flax Journalism Fund, produced in cooperation with SBCAN, so that donations go directly to social justice and environmental reporting. So there are all these different ways that we are reaching out. Our publisher, Brandy Rivera, who's much more an expert on some of this than I am, she's very involved nationally in looking at legislation, you know, legislative changes that are coming down the pike. We're also involved right now in a Google News initiative. Yep, we're taking dollars from Google.
Better than the other way around.
Exactly, and we're used to the other way around. You know, that is part of a digital transformation project. We were one of 40 publishers chosen for this project, and we're working on a specific project for that. But so to sum it up, you know, I would say that everything about the tools that we use has changed, the tools and platforms, but that core reason that we are viable, the core reason that our readers want to, you know, that they need us, and that our advertising clients still want to be in front of those readers, is the local community-focused journalism. So thank you.
Wow. So, Gwyn, you led a group of investors in purchasing the Montecito Journal in 2019 when it was a small standalone print product, and you said improved the paper and also created a bunch of new products, providing alternative revenue streams. Can you talk about what the business model of the Montecito Journal Media Group, LLC, is and how you're trying to navigate this stormy waters that we've heard described?
Well, that's a very good question, Jerry. News, providing news is expensive. Investigative journalism, good investigative journalism, is expensive. And unless people and businesses are willing to pay for it, it's very, very hard to provide it. And one of the things that we've done in the last few years is try to create as many alternative revenue streams as possible that were content-based, that would allow us to be able to pay to put out our newspaper and do it as well as we can. Although our newspaper does make money, and it has made more money every year, we're making money hand over fist. but I will say that. One of the things that we've tried to do is, and let me back up. We have benefited certainly from kind of Montecito being in the world's consciousness as the it girl of places. Thank you, Megan and Harry. But we've tried to create magazines that have real content that you can't finish before you get to the checkout stand. But the truth is, Les Feierstein, my husband, who is the editor of our magazines, I couldn't afford to pay him if I wasn't sleeping with him. And that is the truth. I mean, he's a brilliant writer. He's an incredibly creative mind. But it's very hard to be able to afford great writers. And the people who are great writers in this community are doing it out of a love for journalism and a love for community. But people deserve to be paid. People should be able to pay their rent. People should be able to, send their kids to school. And I think that, Jennifer, you talked a little bit about media literacy. And I think that's very important, but I do believe that we're living in a time where even with media literacy, it's very hard to recognize the truth. And I think that it was interesting because obviously AI, and we haven't talked about that yet, Jerry, and I don't know if you're planning on it, but that is on all of our minds right now. And recently in an interview I was lucky enough to do with Maria Ressa when she was here for the Arts and Lecture Program, she talks about in her book as well that there was a survey done in Silicon Valley amongst the top 800 people who had worked on developing AI, and that 50% of the people who answered the survey said that they believed that it was going to lead to an extinction event. And that means extinction, like us. And, and she talked about that not...
I hope we finish the panel first, though.
Anyway, you asked me for my business model, and the business model is to create really good content that is interesting, some of which we're pushing out well beyond Santa Barbara. Some is just for Santa Barbara. The Giving List... project has been interesting. We're launching our first national Giving List Women, which is a very exciting project. But I will say that I have had more times than I can recount people say to me before they're willing to pay for something, "Are you guys making money on this?" As if there's shame if there's a profit in it, as though we are working for free, as though we are. And I think that's very interesting, and I do think that there's no question that there is a positive correlation between news deserts and corruption, and I think we see it here, frankly.
And I think Santa Barbara, and I'm not from Santa Barbara, I've been here for well over a decade, but this is a small town, and people have long-time relationships, and people have friendships with elected officials, and people have friendships with school officials, and it's hard to write negative things about people you have dinner with, and people you have lunch with, and people who are teaching your kids. But it's critical, and that is for sure the hardest part of my job, our job. So.
All right. Thanks.
I'm not sure I really answered your question.
I'll follow up. Don't worry. So Lily Dallow, you are grew up in Santa Barbara. You are a multimedia journalist who's converted your Cal Poly journalism degree into a gig as digital content director at KEYT. Talk about the multi-platform storytelling skills that you need to do a job like that. What that really involves, and how do you foresee, you know, kind of finding employment doing that sort of thing over the next 5 or 10 years?
Well, luckily I've found employment, so step one. In the film, you said local news is the glue for community, and in my upbringing, that's been social media. So growing up and always knowing what's going on in everybody else's life, it's pretty cool. With that, at the end of the film, you talked about the excitement of when somebody will bring in a picture for the fires, but now everybody takes pictures and everybody posts them. And even now, when I run breaking news, we have to wait for the public information officers to tweet the information. We'll listen to the police scanners and we'll call CHP and the sheriff's office, and they'll say, you know as much as we do. When we find out more, we'll tweet it. So that's our breaking news now. Unless we can send somebody to the scene, which John Palmentary is always there, thankfully. even during the winter storms, when I was going in early from 5 in the morning till 5 p.m., listening to the police scanners, calling all these, local leaders and updating about road closures and posting on social media, and I had all of my friends and family texting me asking what's going on. I'm like, just read my stuff. It's right there. I'd take a break and I'd look at my phone, my group chat with my friends, and one of my friends that lives here sent a TikTok of what's going on, just somebody explaining, stepping outside and showing everybody all the floods, and I'd sit back and I'm like, what am I doing? if everybody can get it that easily. So my hope is that we can grow with the emerging technology and how it's evolving. And in my mind, it's exciting because there's so much communication. I mean, it's a bigger beast because now everybody has a platform to put out their own type of news. But it just makes it even more important that we upkeep the quality of our work. And like you were saying, it's expensive, or it should be. But
All right, thank you. You know, on AI, I have a confession to make, which is I spent a half hour this morning asking GPT to write jokes for this event.
You got one?
And they weren't funny. None of them were funny. It was.
You know what is funny? I actually, when I was trying to prepare for this panel, I was coming up with ideas, and I was having a full-on conversation with ChatGPT about the points I could talk about. They're all my ideas. And the little summary that I wrote out, I texted to myself, and I have it open on my phone in case I needed it. So there's your ChatGPT joke.
What did ChatGPT think of it?
He was like, you're so smart. You don't need me.
Just be yourself. Better than your jokes, Jerry. Jerry, you can't be replaced by AI. Yeah, it's impossible.
No AI, yeah. Although Lily makes me I feel like I'm 92. All right. So Ryan Cruz, also born and raised in Santa Barbara, and in the 3 years you've been at the Independent, you have expanded the paper's recognition and coverage of Spanish-speaking communities that historically have lacked visibility in local media. As Latinos represent a growing portion of the local population, what are the opportunities and obstacles for local news organizations to reach this audience that you see?
Well, that was something that was very important to me when I started working at the Independent, and Brandy and Marianne, they give me the freedom to, you know, to kind of criticize that our coverage was very white-leaning before, and it wasn't for lack of trying. It's really hard to really go and empathize and understand these communities, and growing up here, it's, you know, I felt like it was kind of my responsibility, and I come from these areas, and I am able to connect in a different way and understand where they're coming from, and just having the freedom to be able to do that and reach out in these communities and tell these stories that, like you said, is a big portion of our community, but is not, you know, portrayed in the media in the same way. They do read. They do read the news. They do look up the news, and they always want to be in tune to what's in. And when they see themselves in, and they write back, and, you know, then they start telling their friends, you know, this, they want to tell your story. They can trust you with your story. And that is something that I feel like it's kind of my responsibility and something that I want to keep up in Santa Barbara. And I'm lucky enough to work with Nick Welsh every week and have him, you know, have his long emails after I get publish a story telling me things, you know, well, we could go in this and stuff like that makes me feel very lucky to live in this community. And watching that documentary, one thing that stuck out was Wendy saying, you know, the youth, they're texting, they're on MySpace, they don't read the news, and I'm that youth. She was talking about it at that time. I was probably in high school at that time, and I read the news, and I know that kids my age and people that are grown up now are in tune with the news, and it's in a different way. Like Dr. Holt said, like all you guys are saying, it's on social media, and that is how people get their news, but that's why it's so important to have, you know, journalists who understand and can put things into context, because we're flooded with, you know, a big example is something that just happened, which was a social media-based event that happened in the protest that was a couple blocks away, a couple weekends ago, and that was led through social media, and I found out about it through social media. And with that, there's good and bad, because, you know, an activist that came along with that is somebody that was born and bred on social media and wasn't a trained journalist, so they had a different approach to how they handled it, and, you know, that might not be the most responsible approach. And so when I'm learning about all that information coming in, I'm trying to find out what happened, what was the original incident, what people are upset about, and what's the actual reaction here. And I think that's really important for somebody to be from here to understand things like that, because there were so many posts about that, and you can go into hundreds of comments of people who don't really understand what's going on, but have very passionate opinions. And I think it's important to have, you know, these news sites and newspapers, and I'm lucky to work at somebody that's still doing print in town, and to be able to explain context of these things that are on social media.
Yeah, good, thank you. So Jennifer, I want to build on Lily's comments first. When she talked about all the news is on social media, can you talk about, given that, is there room for quote unquote independent, balanced, fair, whatever word you want to use, news organizations, or are we headed to a place where the whole definition of news is kind of lost into what it is you're seeing on your phone in any particular second?
I think there's certainly space for it. I love listening to what Ryan said, because it's so hopeful that there are people your age that are really starting to kind of think so critically about what you're reading, and that's all I try to get my students to do. So there's certainly space for it. But whether it can survive in the sea of kind of inflammatory, partisan, salacious kind of information that, frankly, is spreading much quicker than anything as banal as a news story. So there is space. It's interesting to think about the idea of space, right, in the spectrum, in the digital spectrum. There's infinite space of some kind. But
there's space for newsmakers. There's space for anything. That's hard.
But to think about how it's rewarded or how it's supported is another deal entirely. And so the news that you all work so hard to create, the news that reputable news organizations create, that is in a very precarious position right now, because the money is being funneled much quicker and in a devastating way, to devastating effect, to disinformation and misinformation and other material that spreads much more easily and readily in the digital space. That business model doesn't care whether it's true or not for people to click on it. In fact, it's better if it's not, because then you're more likely to click. And so, I don't know, the question is, can it survive? That's a thing that keeps me up at night, but there's room.
Can you just say a word about how Google and Facebook became these behemoths, how they, collect 80% or whatever it is of advertising? And then I want to ask Sarah about how that affects her business.
Sure. The interesting thing, I don't know what people know about how ads are bought and sold online. It's kind of like a stock market kind of thing. And Google's parent company, Alphabet, they make 90%+ of their revenue from ad sales, but they also own the infrastructure of that business, and so they own DoubleClick, they own Ad Exchange, they negotiate, they set the prices, and then they sell the ads to themselves. And so it's a great racket, and so the FTC has in the past not found any problem with this arrangement. And when Google purchased DoubleClick around the same time that this was all happening in 2008, they bought it after a bidding war with Microsoft. The FTC said, okay, sounds good. No problem there. And then almost immediately, of course, Google began very predictably restricting its competitors' access to information, privileging its own properties, and by 2020, the company was selling 85% of the ads that it brokered to itself. So they just kind of kept buying up more and more of the intermediaries and the infrastructure of this market that brokers the ads. So a big part of this problem is dealing with billion-dollar digital media conglomerates that we don't control as a society anymore.
Yeah.
Sorry.
No, that's... I'm glad we had this talk.
Pick up on that. Yeah, and jump in on one more sort of related thing is that, when we're talking about, and I don't even want to talk about the billion-dollar giants and how I feel about what Jennifer just said, but, also looking at social media, and like Lily said, that's where a lot of people are getting their news these days, and what Facebook or Meta is doing to the accurate news sources that it is using to disseminate some of the news. They change their algorithms all the time. They punish us sometimes for having accurate, local, well-researched journalism, so there's that whole aspect of it too. But there's what was I going to say? to, you know, to the question of is there space for it, and you know, Ryan and Lily being young and interested in journalism, you know, is that an anomaly? I think locally, at least, all it takes is a story or a topic that you're passionate about, you know, and whether it is like the protest a couple of weeks ago or something that's happening in city council, you know, that's where people realize that. And again, I'll sound like I'm a like an ad for the Independent, but you know, that's when I see what our reporters are doing. And I'll take a topic that most of us are familiar with, given what we just watched. You know, Nick Welsh's cover story about the closing of the News Press. So some of us live and breathe that. But for the community to that is interested in that topic to be able to read that kind of well-researched story that gave history, et cetera, you know, that's the difference between what they're going to get on a, you know, a Twitter post or, you know, on Facebook, and what they're going to get from journalists with historic information that are reporting on any given topic.
Yeah. So Gwyn, you know, obviously the morning paper had been in decline for some years, but now that it's literally out of business, bankruptcy. Are there opportunities for your company, both journalistically and from the business side, that in a funny way this could be helpful to your business, that they've gone to bankruptcy, or do you see it just as a bad thing for all of us altogether?
I see it as a bad thing for all of us altogether. I don't think that losing a daily newspaper in this community is good for anybody. It's a very tough business to be in, the daily news. It's hard enough being the complaint department once a week, being it every day. I think that would be very hard. But it's important. It's really important. And, you know, I want to say that I have a lot of confidence in this generation. I have a ton of confidence in this generation. I think they're smart. I think they're open-minded. And I think that I have this, I do,
they
I really
the,
do.
No, you missed the fist bump.
Oh, okay. I have this framed Mad Magazine. They don't even know what Mad Magazine is, but I have this framed Mad Magazine comic at home of Alfred E. Newman, and he's on this tree swing, a tire swing hanging from a tree, and he's holding up the branch as he's swinging. And he doesn't realize that the branch is not connected to the tree. And there's no subcaption on it, but if there were, it would say, they don't know, he doesn't know he can't, so he can. Or I'd flip it if I were writing well. But I think that we need to think differently about things, and I don't think we're ever going to go back. I don't think you're ever going to put the toothpaste back in the tube. Social media is not going away. But we all have a voice, and I think that we need to insist with our elected officials and, you know, that there are guardrails put on social media. Because that's the problem. The problem is no one takes responsibility for what's printed online. And so lies are allowed to fester and spread, as you said, much faster than the truth ever could. So, I mean, I think that's the problem. But things are going to change. It's going to change, and we're seeing it in front of us. But the one thing I do want to end on is I think that it is a fallacy, a myth, that news was ever an objective thing. I think there's truth that we should all be in pursuit of. But just by virtue of what you report on and what you don't report on, it's subjective. And having come from the television news world, I started at ABC News back in the 80s, and we used to sit in editorial meetings, and every day we'd say, okay, what's above the fold in the New York Times? And 90% of the stories above the fold in the New York Times were put on the cover by Hill & Knowlton, the PR firm, or some other big PR firm. And there were stories that we didn't report on because someone had a relationship with someone in the White House and they didn't. I mean, these kinds of things have always gone on, all the way back to William Randolph Hearst and beyond. So it's not a new thing that there's subjectivity. And and some shading of the truth in journalism. I mean, I think that's not a new thing.
Yeah, I think Carl Bernstein said that it was, you know, your responsibility was to produce the best verifiable version of the truth that day. And that's
a fair.
What they did. So, Lily, so, you know, a lot of the movie was focused on the issue of credibility and who has credibility and, you know, readers want credibility. How do you sort through the zillions of TikToks and tweets and Instagram, whatever the hell they're called, reels, right?
Yeah.
I'm up on it. I mean, how do you, when you sort through, how do you know what is credible and what is not?
You don't, a lot of the time. We make sure that we get all of our video either from our own staff or from official sources. But with videos like the one that went viral the other weekend, that, you know, it's just right there in front of you. The woman saying those words, don't really need to verify that that happened because it's right there in the video. So it's either right there in the video or it's coming from an official source or somebody on our team. But I did want to go back to the conversation about algorithm-based technologies, because as digital director, I've been trying to look into, you know, how to bypass that, which you can't. But to play into it, you have to have really high quality content, and no longer is it just, you know, paper or TV. It's a short video that's not too short to where you're lying or creating clickbait, but it can't be too long. Like on Instagram, you can only post a reel that's a minute and a half, and you don't want to take out any of the critical information because then you're just not being transparent. So it's the length and the quality of that video. And then on top of that, it's what you put in the caption, SEO, search engine optimization, and using the right words and the right hashtags. And then to get to the algorithm, to where the algorithm will support your content, you have to post consistently at the right time, if the stars align, and yeah, just multiple times a week. But in order to produce a video like that, I mean, you have to have the right content. Like for us, we were on the same wavelength as that story that went viral. And so lucky enough, as I was piecing that Instagram reel together, the news came in that the police recommended these charges to the DA. And so I was lucky to be at the front of that when we published the reel with that new bit of information. But originally it was just gonna be that story from the weekend, because that's how, I'm one person. That's how long it takes me to put all that information together into one video, where you're scrolling on your phone and you're looking at a picture of your cousin's newborn baby, and then the next thing is this reel that took a whole day to put together. And if it doesn't hold your attention, you just scroll on to the next one. So it's, if to keep up with, you know, this emerging technology and the algorithms, it's, you need more people at the forefront of it and who learn how to use it. And it can be an extremely powerful tool, just like AI can be, where you can reach, like that reel that I posted has reached over 200,000 views. And there was one that I posted when the whole alien whistleblower things were going, that reached 700,000 views. Like, I've never written a story that reached more than maybe 50,000 views, and that was from the winter storm. So it's a really powerful tool. It's just you have to learn how to use it. And unfortunately, the teachers who are going to teach people how to use it are us right now. So,
as a journalist, how did it make you feel about the state of journalism that 700,000 people watched the guy who said there was an alien at Vandenberg versus the 50,000 that might, you know, maybe for the city council if it gets heated or something?
I mean, people love crazy stuff. It's, you know, it's just the fact. And also, weather content gets a lot of views. And it's just because weather, you know, affects everybody. Traffic, like roadblocks, that's probably right next to it. But then everything below, if people see it and they're like, oh, this doesn't pertain to me, scroll on to the next thing. So It's
President's indicted.
So, Ryan, we've been talking about this story that happened up on Garden Street. Can you just briefly kind of reconstruct how that went down, how you found out about it? Did you just happen to be scrolling and you know, what happened after that?
I mean, I that kind of goes into how we use social media as a tool. I use social media every day. I kind of, not just for entertainment, I follow a lot of people who are actual news sites, and then independent people who just post up-to-date news commentary and stuff like that. And so that was a local activist, Michael Montenegro. He actually posted it, and I talk with him a lot about things that are happening in town, and he posted it, and I first thought he was helping organize it, and then, you know, that's when we start calling our web manager, and he was able to go down there and be there, take some videos and photos. And that whole time I'm, you know, DMing people, calling people, and that's something that we probably use a lot more than journalists in the movie that we saw. Like, DMing and reaching out through social media is a viable way to meet sources, get credible information from people who, because they can see there right away when they get a DM, and that's, they're on their Instagram and they're on their TikTok just as much as I am. So I found out through that, and then I start kind of trying to...
This is the lady who got in the beef with the construction.
Yeah, so the video itself came out, and of course, it made a lot of people upset. And then it was the phenomenon of this person who has a huge following kind of jumping on this cause. And it's kind of, it's a symptom of these times that we have people that are, you know, making money or making a living just as a personality, an influencer. And that doesn't always mean they are a credible journalist, because, you know, he kind of, to tell honestly, he messed up the reporting for me, because he had portrayed himself as a journalist, and he posted a video where he was on the phone with this woman, and he said, "I'm a journalist," and, you know, that made me upset, like, in my stomach, to hear people that aren't actually doing reporting, you know, portraying them. And then when I call her, you know, of course she says, "I've been burned before. This guy said he was a journalist." So you have to work around, and the rules are just different nowadays, and it's a whole different landscape. And I kind of just think I'm lucky that I don't know the before times. I don't know what it's like to have a newsroom with, you know, a lot of people, or we have to be very resourceful, and that's using social media and trying to, you know, find how my story can be informative to my community, people that are from here, in a different way than, you know, I could have leaned into what this guy was doing and make it about street vendors and this huge thing, when I didn't think that was the case. I think it was this really offensive video and situation, and that's what should be followed up on. And I tried to stay focused to what that was for our community, and that's what I wanted to put out in the story.
All right, the hour's late. I want to ask one more question and just get everybody's take on this. Tom Rosensteel, who's the executive director of the American Press Institute, said recently, "If we don't monitor power at the local level, there will be massive abuse of power at the local level." And the media critic Margaret Sullivan says, "When local news fails, the foundations of democracy weaken. The public, which depends on accurate factual information in order to make good decisions, suffers. The consequences may not always be obvious, but they are insidious." Shout out cannabis ordinance. So what do you see as the future of local news, as that public interest, public trust, doing it to serve readers and viewers and taxpayers? Is there a future that is financially sound or not, do you think, Jennifer?
I mean, I'm feeling the gospel of Ryan over here. I mean, and Lily, I mean, you know, to me, I actually do learn quite a bit about my local community on TikTok, and I love it. I find it totally fascinating. I wouldn't try to venture to predict.
It's
a fool's errand. But I do see the energy around social media. I see the energy around. I'm very heartened by how seriously you take journalistic ethics on social media platforms to create news. That does my heart so much good, and that gives me massive amounts of hope. As for the news organizations themselves, there's always going to be a need and a huge desire for local news. So we just have to find a way to support it. But I don't think the desire for it will go away, and I don't think the passion for telling local stories and keeping local officials accountable will ever go away. The financial support is what we need to protect somehow.
I will answer your question with a resounding yes. I do not have all the answers. We're working to find those answers and to grow those answers every single day. It's funny, you know, I am not dazzled so much by listening to Ryan talk, because when I have the privilege of being in or near our newsroom, that's what they're living and breathing every day. And yeah, the film we watched tonight, you know, when you read some of Wendy's answers, not in Wendy's official voice, that's what we're combating. You know, we are, and I say we, I mean all legit local, or not local, you know, all legit journalistic enterprises are working to preserve that every day. That, you know, I see that in action. I see that with what you do, Jerry. I see that with all of our local media companies. The challenge is monetizing it. And I won't repeat myself, but that's what I've been in the trenches working on for 37 years. It's changed, but we just have to keep changing with it. And we are.
Yeah. Gwyn, you wrote a really lovely column about the news press going down a couple of weeks ago and talked about the importance to democracy and those issues. What do you think? Is there a sustainable interest and market for that kind of important information that you referenced that local news ought to be producing?
I think so, and I think it's there must be. There must be, and I think it takes serious, concerted investigative reporting to really understand what's going on behind closed doors in government, especially these, maybe always. But I think it's a big problem in our country. I think it's a big problem in our town, to be honest. And in general, as a general rule, I don't think it's a good idea when billionaires own newspapers. I don't think it's a good idea when billionaires run for president. I think that one of the things that worked out really well when I raised money to buy the newspaper was that I actually went into it hoping that one or two people would write a really big check, and it didn't work out that way, and I ended up with 30 investors, which turned out to be inadvertently brilliant, so I take no responsibility for it, but it was the best thing that happened, because absolutely no one has any say in what we write about or what we do, and in fact, one of our investors, as he signed the deal, looked at me and said, you know, this is the worst deal I've ever signed in my life. And I took great pride in that. But it has freed us up to do whatever we want. So in short, I think we need alternative revenue streams. I think that people need to understand the importance of journalism and support it. And I think we need to be brave, and I think we need to be willing to lose in order to win. And that means offending some of our friends and taking a serious approach to trying to tell the truth about what's going on.
Lily, you had a piece. About the marshal of the Fiesta Parade, and it was more than a piece, because it was made of multiple parts. There was, you had a story with actual words. You had You had social media videos. You also had an extended video clip of the interview. Do you think that the written word is over, and that really video, short videos, is going to be what people are going to be only looking at in the short to midterm future?
I don't think it's over, because it all starts from the written word, at least on my end. And when I went into journalism, it was because I wanted to write. That's literally the seed that started all this, that got me to here on the stage. But as I went through Cal Poly, and it was there, journalism is a Bachelor of Science because of all the technology that we use and all the media that we learn. It just got me even more excited. Like, there's just so much more to it. You know, I can still write, but on top of it, I get to portray these stories in different ways, where you're not only just reading it, but you get to watch it, you get to hear it, you get to comment about it. And you know, the goal is to open up communication about this and bring people together and amplify these stories. So I think that it's just exciting the way that it's going.
All right. Ryan, there was a Pan American study in 2019 that said as local journalism declines, government officials conduct themselves with less integrity, efficiency, and effectiveness, and corporate malfeasance goes unchecked. With the loss of local news, citizens are less politically informed, less likely to vote, and less likely to run for office. You know, we had 65 people in the News Press newsroom, Ryan, and I don't know, maybe half a dozen you have now in the independent full-time doing that. How overwhelmed do you feel by the the kinds of things that Gwyn references are going on in our community that we're not able to get to?
It's trying to do as much as you can with the resources you have. And of course, if we had 20 people, I could focus my whole every two weeks on one story, and I could bury myself in that. And when we have a cover story, we kind of do that, but we also have to cover the day-to-day stuff. And it's just the pace is changed, and I think I'm used to that, and I don't know any different. But to me, it's really important to cover City Hall, cover things that are happening in the community, because people do care. People care about housing. People care about these big topics, about trying to pay their rent. It's a huge thing in Santa Barbara. And to make sure that the things that are happening in the boardrooms, in City Council, are reflecting what the community is actually thinking and is going through. State Street is always a huge thing. Anything that having to do with hotels, because it's a bigger thing than just another hotel being approved. It's what direction are we going, and people are seeing that. And like Dr. Holt said, not everybody has media literacy, and not everybody has civics literacy, and not everybody knows how the process works and when to go talk at City Council. So it's really important to have somebody who can put it into context and let people know what's happening and what decisions are being made, and then what these leaders are saying, and making sure those decisions reflect that. And if they're not, the stories can point out what is different there.
All right. All right. Well, we're going to leave it there. Thank you. Dr. Jennifer Holt, Sarah Sinclair, Gwyn Lurie, Lily Dallow, and Ryan P. Cruz. And thank all of you for coming tonight and for hanging in with us. It's been a great evening. Thank you.